There is not ample amount of praise one can provide to our armed forces, who without any second thought surrender their life for our nation's defense and also help in keeping national internal security and stability. Hello everyone, my name is Satyam Shivaj. I am an intern with Lexus & Company, and in this video, we will discuss about armed force law and their judicial system. Now, what is military law and military justice system? Military law, which is formulated in the form of statutes, rules and regulation provisions to administer the role of the Indian military services during peace and war. The formal publication mainly takes the form of the Army Act 1950, Army Rule 1954, Regulation for the Army 1987, 1958 Armed Force Special Power Act and the Armed Force Tribunal Act 2007. Military law is a body of law and procedure that governs the soldier personnel and their conduct. It deals with legal issues that are unique to military justice, include the preservation of excellent order and discipline, the lawfulness of order, and military members' proper conduct. Military justice system is a system where some countries use different and separate judicial bodies an arrangement to administer justice for military personnel or in respect to anything which is in accordance with the military law. Military law is distinct from martial law, which is the imposition on a civil population of military authority as a substitute for civil authority, and is often declared in the times of emergency, war or civil unrest. Most countries limit when and how martial law can be declared or enforced. Now let's see what is military justice in India. India has its own Army Act, Air Force Act and Navy Act. These laws define the statutory provisions as being applicable to men and ladies in uniform. In India too, there are certain paramilitary forces that have law almost like people who apply to defense services. This include the Border Private Security Force Act, the Coast Guard Act, Border Police Act of Indo-Tibet, and Assam Rifle Act. All of those acts are inspired by the Military Act. The original motive with which the British developed military justice was to enable discipline in India after the mutiny of 1857. The main objective of the Army Act 1950, the Navy Act 1957, and the Air Force Act 1950. Before being adopted by independent India, only a couple of changes were made to the British law. For different reasons, the necessity for a separate justice scheme for the soldiers arisen. Military function requires rapid decision making. The subordinates perform the order of a commander. That is why all military forces have a hard and fast hierarchy system. This put all the people in the position that's clearly designated. Moreover, since the soldiers aren't a deliberate body and have developed their own law and tradition, they recognize unique military offenses like desertion, disobedience of order, absence without leave, dereliction of duty, etc. Now let's see the defect within the Indian military system. The Military Act reflects the old justice system prevailing in British time, and maybe because of that it consists many defects. And removal of these defects becomes the interest of the military person, and some of them being, let's start with the right to bail. An arrested military person has no provision for bail. The superior military authority may plan to grant it on the idea of their discretion. The apex court has established the principle on which bail should be granted, but granting bail at somebody's discretion is bigoted and unreasonable. Military rules doesn't allow an accused to get a civil lawyer to defend him or to be defended by any officer referred to as a defending officer. The shortage of legal aid service. This provision infringes one of the rights enshrined in Constitution, that is Article 21 of the Indian Constitution. Now coming to the trial during a summary court martial. Trial of accused military personnel is held during a special court referred to as summary court martial. The SCM trial doesn't match the amount of justice set by the apex court and various high court. Just because there is no prosecutor, and therefore the SCM performs a number of functions of the prosecutor themselves. serious infringement of Article 22 of the Indian Constitution occurs when the accused can't defend himself with the assistance of a lawyer or a defense officer. SCMs are severely criticized by the Supreme Court and the High Court for following the just and fair reasonableness test. Now there is double jeopardy. Article 20 clause 2 of the Indian Constitution provides the constitutional protection against prosecution. It is available within the military justice process, but this protection isn't available before a civil court to stop a second trial on an equivalent offense. There is also no right to appeal. There is no provision for the accused to appeal during the higher court. The Military Act states that any individual who considers himself grieved by a finding of a sentence of a court martial may file a petition with the central government, the chief of military, or any prescribed superior officer in command of that one that confirmed the finding or sentence. And therefore, the central government, the chief military, or the chief of military, or the other officer may pass such order, because the case could also be of Section 164, Clause 2 of Military Act. This remedy is additionally just a paper exercise and occurs in closed room where the accused doesn't have the proper to non-public representation. There is virtually no right to appeal against the court martial law, martial order. Then there is a member of court martial. The members aren't trained to administer justice, either legally qualified or not. They are under the various commanding influence and doesn't exercise their judgment completely independently during a trial. Now let's talk about Armed Force Tribunal in India. The Armed Force Tribunal and its benches have been operating since 2009. The tribunal has original jurisdiction over matter relating to service and appeals court martial jurisdiction. The tribunal is unable to execute its order through the civil contempt. If someone want to make an appeal, then they can brought it before the Supreme Court against the tribunal's order. An amendment to this Armed Force Tribunal Act 2007 provide for the resentment of the armed force in 2012 to civil contempt and provides with no jurisdiction in grievances concerning leave, post, transfer, summary disposal and trials. A large number of cases has occurred in which the military or government has failed to take action on the tribunal's decision. That is all for today's video. Thank you.